Do you have sleep problems? Insomnia, restless leg syndrome, sleep apnea, snoring, or maybe just wake up to pee in the middle of the night and then you can't fall back to sleep? An estimated 30% of the population at any given time is struggling with their sleep, so you're not alone. And naturally, we go looking for sleeping hacks and tricks and nutritional supplements that can help us to sleep better. If you fall under that category, this video is for you. Hey, my name's Lucas. I am a yoga teacher. I'm a breathing coach. And as a breathing coach, a huge part of my work focuses on nocturnal breathing patterns, how you sleep and breathe. And you can't look at sleep or breathing patterns without looking at what goes in your mouth and your mind right before bed, whether that's blue light from your laptop, whether that's alcohol or food, or whether that's any of the myriad of nutritional supplements and pills that people take before they sleep. I'm also someone who has struggled with sleep most of my adult life, off and on, up and down. So both personally and professionally, sleep and the study and the struggle with sleep is something I'm very familiar with. Hopefully what I've learned can be of help to you. Quick disclaimer here, I'm not a medical doctor. Sleep problems can be very serious. Please use this for educational purposes only. Before we jump in and talk about CBD, melatonin, and magnesium, let's just look at the landscape of sleep to give you some ideas. The first thing is that sleep quality is very poor. As we mentioned, restless sleep, getting up, shaking, light sleep, insignificant sleep, but an even bigger problem is just lack of sleep, right? Not sleeping enough. A 2010 workers study revealed that about 30% of the respondents in the study were self-reporting sleeping less than 6 hours per night. When you sleep less than 6 hours per night, all kinds of negative consequences arrive. Mental, emotional, psychological challenges go through the roof. Driving is very dangerous. An estimated 20% of all car accidents, drowsiness is contributing to those car accidents. When sleep deprivation, less than 6 hours per night, is chronic, suddenly you have this imbalance that can contribute or even cause things like cardiac arrest, type 2 diabetes, metabolic dysfunction, weight gain, neurodegenerative decline. Pretty much all of the negative, scary stuff in health can be directly correlated with a lack of sleep, especially long term. Now, the jobs where people reported the least sleep were things like healthcare, believe it or not, service jobs, mining, utilities, people working shift work, flight staff, things like this. But the reality is this lack of sleep and poor quality of sleep, it affects almost all of us. Not sure about you, but for over a decade, I was convinced that I was a different breed, that I had special genetics that allowed me to sleep just 5.5 hours. And I was really, really wrong. Sleeping less than 6 hours is pretty much across the board dangerous. Here's what Matthew Walker has to say about sleeping less than 6 hours per night.
The number of people who can survive on 6 hours of sleep or less without showing any impairment, rounded to a whole number and expressed as a percent of the population, is zero.
So we can all agree that undersleeping is bad for you. We can all agree that poor quality of sleep is bad for you. But then what do? You get into bed and you toss and you turn, you wake up and you're not sleeping. So that's when we take a look at our alternatives. Today, we'll look at three supplements. We'll start off by looking at CBD. Cannabidiol is the actual chemical name. And CBD has really exploded in popularity in the past 10 years as the legalization and decriminalization of cannabis has really swept across the world. It shows no sign of slowing. So probably products like these will become more and more abundant. Now, the research on CBD and sleep specifically is still pretty light, and it's interesting, but not that exciting. I personally have used CBD in various forms for over a decade, and I'll share with you both my personal experience and also the experiences that I've pulled from the research from Whoop. Whoop is a fitness tracker company, and because they have so many people wearing devices and self-reporting pre-bed CBD use, they have a really, really large data set that's even difficult to replicate in clinical trials. In any case, what you will find with CBD is that it usually does initially reduces sleep latency. That means you fall asleep faster. Initially, like the first couple of days, it can also increase the quality of your sleep. Specifically, your REM sleep can boost up a little bit. There's a couple of big problems with CBD. The biggest problem that nobody talks about is that your tolerance goes up very, very fast. Marijuana users are familiar with the fact that tolerance to marijuana goes up very, very quickly. The exact same is true with CBD. Within a couple of days, a week at the most, you might need double or triple the dose to do the same thing. And eventually it just stops being effective at all. You just fall right off a cliff. And what used to help you fall asleep and give you amazing REM sleep suddenly is totally ineffective. To add to the insult, this stuff is expensive. There's a lot of cheap CBD out there, but most of those have very, very low potency. for a high potency CBD extract that comes from cannabis, not from hemp. Cannabis is the plant that has a lot more cannabinoids, whereas hemp is more of an industrial grade plant. These are going to cost you a lot of money. This is a $100 bottle of CBD, for example. So you can imagine when you're taking a drop or two per night, okay, that's no big deal, but then you're at 10 drops and 20 drops. And when you couple that with the fact that these usually have carrier oils, suddenly you're taking a whole bunch of an oil, can make your stomach upset, you wake up groggy, you have diarrhea, and you're not really sleeping very well. Those are some of the big drawbacks with CBD. So what is my conclusion on CBD? You gotta find a really good manufacturer, which is hard. There's a lot of charlatan companies selling weird tinctures, and a lot of them are very, very weak in terms of potency. So you gotta find a really good brand. You probably have to invest a bunch of money. And then what you're really looking at is either spot therapy. For example, I probably use this a dozen times throughout the year at the most, or really, really irregular use, only when you need to. Otherwise, it's gonna be very expensive and very ineffective. That's CBD. The next supplement, which is way more popular and never more popular than right now, is melatonin. Melatonin can be bought in almost every pharmacy. It's very, very inexpensive, and it's a really, really problematic supplement that people don't think about. Here's the way that it works. Melatonin is like a circadian rhythm regulator. In the morning, we have a cortisol spike, hormone cortisol. In the evening, we have a melatonin spike. Now, that's in an ideal world. Cortisol and melatonin are kind of the yang and the yin. They're the day and the night hormones, but they get kind of screwed up. Stress can make our cortisol spike at 9 p.m., and exposure to lights, like from your laptop, can make your melatonin go down at 11 p.m., for example. And so we think, oh, why don't we just take some melatonin? Well, the big challenge with melatonin is it's actually a hormone. It's secreted endogenously in your pineal gland. And so naturally, you would get a melatonin spike towards the evening. If you start to take exogenous melatonin, meaning taking a pill form, it can potentially stifle or even turn off your pineal gland's production of melatonin. Not a good thing when we're talking about hormones. Hormones are very complex and they work in an orchestra. When one hormone goes up, some hormones follow it. When one hormone goes up, some hormones go down. So taking something like melatonin on a regular basis can, not necessarily, but can potentially mess up your sex hormones, testosterone and estrogen. It can mess up your cortisol levels, dysregulate that morning cycle. It can mess up your growth hormone, and it can mess up your thyroid hormones as well. Now, is this going to happen if you take it a few times a year? Almost certainly not. If you take melatonin here and there when you have jet lag, is that going to turn off your pineal gland? Definitely not. But long-term use is a real problem. And the bigger problem with these is it's very difficult to know what you're taking. Just like with CBD and just like with all nutritional supplements, it's unregulated. And for whatever reason, melatonin production is a mess. When they start to look at and analyze different supplements, they find that some supplements have way more than is on the label. Some supplements have way less. And when you're messing around with hormones, you really want a specific amount. You want to know what you're taking. Here's what Dr. Shaw at Mount Sinai has to say about melatonin.
Most of the evidence shows that it ranges anywhere from having none to about 400% of what is listed on the label.
So we've got essentially a hormone in a bottle. We're not so sure on the dosage. And to complicate things, oddly, we mentioned that CBD is often underdosed. It's very weak. Melatonin is often overdosed. I'm not sure why, but there's often much more than is on the label, or the label itself is already giving you way too much. It's giving you 10 milligrams when an active dose for most people would be 0.5 to 3 milligrams. And again, we're talking about hormones here, not vitamin C. You don't want to just take more and more and more. What can the side effects be? Well, you could wake up with kind of a sleep hangover with grogginess. It can mess with your mood. But again, more concerning is this symphony of hormones when you start taking these things long-term. The best way to think about melatonin is as a circadian rhythm reset. Maybe you have an international flight and you're changing three time zones. That would be an appropriate time to take a very small one or two night dose of melatonin. This would be 3-4 times a year at the most. And by small dose, I mean maybe 0.5 to 3 milligrams. And you're doing that to reset your body's circadian rhythm. Taking this every night, really, really bad idea. Choosing any random brand you find on the shelves of your pharmacy, also a pretty risky venture. Okay, lastly, we have, you probably guessed it, my favorite, which is magnesium. Magnesium, to call it a nutritional supplement is exaggerated. It's actually just a mineral in the same way you'd find salt or you'd buy chalk. Magnesium is really in this category. It's a mineral. It's extremely abundant in the world. It's extremely abundant in your body. It's the third most abundant mineral in your body. Most of you don't have a true magnesium deficiency, but a magnesium imbalance, very, very common. Why? We get magnesium in dark leafy green vegetables. We get it in nuts and seeds. We get it from dark chocolate, some kind of beans. Many people eat these foods, but maybe not as much as they should. Magnesium is really important for heart health, blood pressure, nervous system, relaxing your muscles, and a whole host of other metabolic processes. When you take magnesium or when you eat more magnesium, it can help with your sleep. And unlike these other supplements, which over time can start to have impacts in other parts of your health, magnesium's benefits, they're really pro-health in all other aspects as well. When you take magnesium, you can certainly take it in a capsule form like I have here, 200 to 400 milligrams a night, or you could simply up your intake of magnesium-rich foods. Either option is totally viable. In the short term, however, most of you are going to get better results from taking a supplement. Very, very safe, very common. The biggest thing you need to watch out for is digestibility. If you take too much magnesium or you take the wrong form or a form that doesn't suit you, you can end up with a really uncomfortable belly, gas, and bloating, which really negates any sleeping benefits that you might have had. There's a number of different forms of magnesium, and there's no shortage of supplement manufacturers with marketing that tells you you need this special combo or this $100 bottle. None of that is true. There's just a handful of common formats. Magnesium citrate is probably the most common that you'll find. This upsets a lot of people's belly. Magnesium glycinate and the glycinate groups tend to be the best digested. A lot of people also like magnesium threonate. These are all very inexpensive. The manufacturer, unlike these, doesn't really matter. Again, this is very similar to buying salt or chalk. Buy whatever's economical, but do focus on how your belly feels. Start off with less, 200 milligrams. Start off with food to ease with your digestion. Pay attention to your belly and pay attention to your sleep. Now, I'll warn you, you're not going to feel this dunk, fuzzy hammer bunk over the head like you might feel with some of these stronger supplements initially. But over time, it can actually be very, very helpful for sleep. Keep in mind, too, for those of you with restless leg syndrome, muscle cramps, body aches, and pains, very, very likely that magnesium can help with that as well. In terms of brands and companies, I don't do any kind of endorsement here, so I'd encourage you to seek out the best ones you can. With the exception of magnesium, I would simply buy whatever is most affordable for you in the magnesium glycinate group. Hope you found this helpful. If you'd like more information about sleep, I'd encourage you to check out the work of Matthew Walker and his book, which I'll put a link to down below. If you'd like more science-based yoga videos, stress videos, breathing videos, hit subscribe down below. If you have experience with any or all of these, love to hear from you down in the comments below. And my teaching calendar is at yogabody.com.